We've tested a self-heated lithium battery by putting it in the freezer for 24 hours and charging it up. Now the results are in and it's a big fail.
Hi, my name's Steve. I'm the CEO and founder of Roma Batteries. And today I'm going to talk to you about charging lithium batteries in cold temperatures. Now, batteries don't like being used in very cold temperatures, and this is true of all batteries. Lead-acid batteries will temporarily lose capacity and can struggle to deliver high currents, but that's pretty much it. Now, lithium batteries actually perform better than lead-acid when discharging, but you do need to be careful when you're charging. Fast charging a lithium battery when it's very cold leads to something called lithium plating, and this can irreversibly damage the cells. You can permanently lose capacity, and there's also a risk of internal short circuits, which in a worst case scenario can lead to a lithium battery fire. This is why all decent lithium leisure batteries now come with low temperature charge protection. The battery management system blocks charging if the temperature drops below zero and allows charging again when it warms up. It's simple, but it's effective. What we're looking at today is self-heating batteries, which are becoming a lot more popular as a way to hack this process. Now, the idea with these is instead of waiting till they warm up normally, they heat themselves up very quickly and then you can carry on charging as normal. Now, it sounds like a smart idea, right? Well, yes, but it really depends on how this is implemented. Okay, a good example is a Tesla Powerwall. So they use very small cylindrical cells that look like this. Okay, they then have a liquid coolant system that distributes heat evenly around all of the cells and a BMS that regulates the charge current. So basically it's a well-engineered system that ensures you don't get any hot spots, any frozen bits in the middle of the cells. Okay, so here we have a self-heated lithium leisure battery. Now, I'm not going to mention who makes this because there's lots of companies out there that make self-heated batteries. They look and work just like this one. We're going to take this apart and show you how it works. Now, at Roma, we've decided not to install heaters inside our batteries. And I want to explain a little bit about why we made that decision, but also what our advice is on how to use batteries in the cold, how you can install them, and some tips on getting the most out of them. Okay, so I've got the self-heated battery here and I've taken it out of its case so I can show you how it works. And the first thing to notice is that these self-heated batteries, they use prismatic cells. So these are much thicker, much bigger than the little cylindrical ones that I showed you earlier. And bear in mind, this is a small 105 amp hour battery. So the cells on this one are 3.6 centimeters thick. They weigh 2 kilos each. Some of the larger self-heated batteries actually use cells that are up to 7 centimeters thick. So that weighs 5.5 kilos like this. So this is a big solid chunk of metal, and imagine you've got 8 of those in a pack. So the heating system of this self-heated battery consists of a thin heating film wrapped around the outside of the cell pack. This is this green paper material here. Notice that this film only covers the sides of the cells. There's no heating on the top or the bottom or in between the cells. So there are 3 temperature readings showing on the Bluetooth BMS app for this battery. So we'll take that, there must be 3 sensors. Now we found 2 of these. Sensor number 1 on the top here, it's on the negative pole of the terminal. The second one is down the side of this pack. It's actually touching the heat film and it would normally be inside the insulation board. Now the third one, we assume must be on the BMS board itself, it must be internal. Now I'm not sure which one controls the charge protection or the heating control, but we can demonstrate that later as we test it. So Roma batteries have 4 temp sensors, but it's a very similar arrangement to what we've got here. We've actually added a 4th temp sensor to this one, but what we've done is we've put the temp sensor in between the cells so that we can try and understand what's going on inside the cell pack rather than just the surface temperature, which is what these are measuring here. Okay, so it's time to put this to the test. It should be fairly simple. We've had this battery in the freezer for 24 hours. You can see it's pretty frosty right now, and it'll be frozen all the way through. You can see on our K-type thermocouple temp sensor here, using the flute meter, that we're about minus 17 degrees on the inside of the pack. In terms of the BMS readings, they're pretty similar. They showed a very cold, so we're pretty sure that these are consistent temperature readings we're getting. To monitor the self-heating battery, we've got the BMS temperature reading on the Bluetooth app. We also have a thermal camera, so we can do some external readings and see what's going on and how that heat is distributed around the pack. So here we have our freezer set up. We're using an app called the Xiaojiang BMS. This is a generic app that works with a JBD BMS, which is used on a lot of batteries that are out there. And obviously we've got our fluke meter. So we can see the readings here at minus 12.5 on the fluke, which is showing the internal cell pack temperature. And then we've got our 3 temperature sensors
on the BMS here. Now, these are pretty consistent, so we're happy that that's stabilized. You notice it says that charging is still enabled on here. Now, that's just a quirk of the app. What will happen as soon as we apply a charge current to it, that charge protection will kick in and the heating will turn on. See the charge under temperature protection has kicked in. Now we're going to watch the temperatures and see what happens. So now that the protection's in place, the heat film has actually been activated, so this battery should warm up and it should start allowing a charge. Now it's important to note that we're watching here the comparison between what the battery thinks the temperature is and what the temperature inside the cell pack is. Okay. When this charge is enabled, then we're going to see what happens.
So we've paused it here because this is the point where the BMS has started allowing charging again. The charge protection is configured to release when the battery is plus 5 degrees. So we can see that this occurs on temperature sensor number 2. The other two readings don't seem to affect cold temperature protection. I'm assuming they're just for high temperatures. So the important value to look at is the one on the fluke meter. So this is shown minus 4.3 degrees. And I'll repeat that because the temperature between the cells is minus 4.3 degrees when the charging starts. And notice also that when the charging does start, the pack voltage jumps up above 14 volts. So this is another clear indication that the cell pack is too cold. Internal resistance of lithium cells increases as temperature drops. So that's demonstrated here. So when we start pumping in 35 amps, the voltage jumps up. It's also why the state of charge estimate skips to 100%. It's basically calibrated itself because it sees that high voltage and thinks it's full. Also notice that the voltage on cells 2 and 3 is a lot higher than cells 1 and 4 when charging starts. So this is because these two cells are on the inside of the cell pack. They're colder than the two on the outside, so the resistance is higher. Here's a thermal image of the cell pack, and you can see exactly what I mean. The heat is very unevenly distributed. The two outside cells are much warmer than the two inside cells, which looks to be completely frozen. So the inside of the battery is still well below 0 degrees when this charging starts.
Okay, so after our test, the conclusion is that quite clear that self-heated leisure batteries do not work as intended. The BMS allowed charging to start when the external temperature sensor reached 5 degrees, which is correct, but the inside of the battery was still below freezing. Bear in mind that these cells are only 3.6 centimeters thick, 2 kilograms each. The results would likely have been a lot worse with larger cells like this one. Charging at high amps at these sort of low temperatures has almost certainly caused lithium plating to the cells and permanently damage them. Now, I'd like to give this a few more cycles and see what happens, but that's gonna have to wait for another day. The other conclusion is that heating film around the outside of the battery only warms the surface while the center remains cold. These temperature gradients inside the cells are gonna lead to non-uniform ion movement. It's going to cause lithium plating. This will permanently damage your battery. If self-heating batteries are not the answer, then what is?
My name's Alex, I work for Roma and I do their system designs, but I also spend my winter living in the Arctic, so lithium batteries and cold temperature is quite a big deal to me. Whilst we talked about the issues with way self-heated batteries are implemented, let's talk about solutions available to us here at Roma. First off, the main thing to remember with lithium batteries and cold temperature turn-off is the battery itself doesn't turn off, it's only charging. Discharge still works on most of our rate Smart 4 range down to minus 20 and our extreme range down to minus 40, but we'll get onto that later. The second point is when you're away in your camper van. There's a common myth, they go, oh, I've got the heating on in the van, it's 20 degrees, but my battery is warm. That doesn't work. The big issue is lots of people install their batteries in their garage of their vehicle or in the bottom of the cupboard. There's no heat or air circulation there. The battery gets cold. And the second issue is they place the battery on the floor, so they have a 100% cold bridge with a very cold area of the van. So how can you better implement that? The easiest way is to literally jack the battery up. Insulated boxes are great, but if you've still got their insulation on the floor, you're just delaying the heat loss. So one of the best solutions I found is to put an air gap below the battery, so you're taking away that 100% cold bridge with the cold floor of your vehicle, even if it's insulated, and you're decreasing that by up to 95% or more. The other option is the Roma Extreme series, which uses a different type of cell, which can still be charged at minus 30. It's still the same chemistry, LiFePO4, but it uses a different type of electrolyte.
Okay, so just a few final thoughts. Roma don't use cell heaters inside our batteries. It would actually be a fairly cheap addition. It costs us about £2 to add that, and our BMS is capable of supporting it. we've deliberately chosen not to. Hopefully the test results demonstrate why we've done that. I think if you also look at other brands, other premium brands, especially your MG Energies, Victron and so on, they don't do that either. Until we can see the technology improve, until we can see safety certifications that back that up, we're certainly going to stay away from it. Now, I don't actually feel that the tech is that bad. I think the idea of heating the cells is a good one overall. It's just the implementation is bad. When you've got a cell that's this sort of size, trying to heat it from the outside is just like trying to heat up a frozen chicken in a frying pan. It's just not going to work. I think if you were to use smaller cells like this one, and there was a way to wrap those cells individually, I think that certainly would work a lot better. So overall, the slower that the cell pack warms up, the more consistent that temperature is going to be. And the more consistent the temperature is, the better that's going to be for the long-term health and safety of your battery. I do have some safety concerns about this. Having done a lot of research and testing with the Extreme battery, looking at how lithium plating can permanently damage those cells and can shorten the life, can reduce capacity, and the buildup of those dendrites on the cells can actually potentially cause short circuits and bigger problems. I think this requires more testing before this is done as a consumer product.